Hello. At the end of last time, we were learning about directed acyclic graphs, DAG. And what I'm showing here is a pretty ex simple example of a DAG. For the D part, directed, I can see that my edges are like arrows, right? They point in one direction. For acyclic, even though it might look like there's some sort of cycle structure, there's really not because these arrows are all pointing in the one direction. If I start at A, for example, and I go to B and then D, I can't cycle back to A because they're pointing kind of forwards, right? I can't loop back, right? So that's acyclic, and of course it's a graph, so that's the G, so DAG. Now, in this section, we're going to learn about another kind of graph called the tree, and just the big picture here, right, is that directed graphs are a type of graph, DAGs are a type of directed graph, and trees are a type of DAG. And what we're going to try to eliminate with trees is this kind of branching and then merging back together behavior. And so to accomplish that, we're going to introduce two new rules. And the first rule is that we have one node with exactly no parents, and we're going to call that the root. Actually, up here on this one, I could call this a root. Right, there's that one doesn't have any parents. There's exactly one with no parents. But it's not a tree because of the second rule, which is that any additional nodes besides the root have to have exactly one parent. And I can see that for D, that's not true. D has two parents, both B and C. So I have down here an example of a tree where, you always have the root, and in most cases, I kind of draw it at the top. Maybe somebody might draw it at the bottom. It doesn't really matter where. The root is the node that has no parent. It doesn't have any edges pointing at it. It only has edges going out. And so I see that here, right? So that one has no parents. And every other node in the picture, besides that root, has exactly one parent, right? A node can have multiple children, right? But there's no node with multiple parents. And so there's a couple things I can say about trees in general, kind of beyond like really simple trees that might have one node. And one is that they will never be connected, strongly connected. And the reason being is that all these arrows kind of go in one direction, right? So once I go down, there's no heading back up, right? Once I leave the root, I can't get back to it because the root has no parents, right? So these trees are never strongly connected, but they're all weakly connected, right? Because everything has to flow off from one root. I can't have multiple roots with no parents, right? So they're always going to be weakly connected, meaning that if I were to ignore the direction of the edges, well, then I could reach everything from everything. So it's kind of one big piece. So what I'm going to start doing now is to actually write some Python code, and for this, right? I mean, we've been doing all this kind of visualization work, but how do we actually write kind of classes that represent trees? And the key in almost all of these cases is that we're going to have some sort of node class. And so let me just kind of copy and paste something here I have from another example. Let me just grab it just a moment. I'm copying from another monitor. I'll paste this down here. And let me run that. And well, what is this? This was an example that we've kind of worked with a little bit in class and a little bit during lab. And this right now is for a linked list. And a linked list is actually a type of tree, a very simple type of tree. Well, why is that? Let me just kind of paste one more thing here so I can look at an example of what a linked list will look like. So we kind of have a picture in mind. So here's an example of a linked list, right? There's kind of just one node after the other after the other. And I can use those to store a sequence of values. This picture here is absolutely, excuse me. It's absolutely, sorry, let me just paste this. It's absolutely a tree. I mean, I have one node that's the root, A, has no parents, and everything else has exactly one parent. Now, a linked list is not just any type of tree, it's a type of tree that where each node has at most one child, right? There's, you know, when I look at a kind of a general tree up here, I see it branches out in different ways. When I head down here, I can see, well, each node has at most one child until I get to the end. And that end, the special vocabulary for that would be called a leaf. And so just let's review this code a little bit, because I'm going to take this linked list code and I'm going to turn it into some kind of tree, right? And so what's going on here? Well, I have my init, my constructor, where I take a value and I put that value in my node, and then I say next equals none. And so what I can do down here is I can create a few nodes, L1, L2, L3, and then I can make that first node point to the second and the second node point to the third, right? Attributes being references to other objects are really one way to represent edges, right? So I'm using a class for my nodes, and I'm using just a regular attribute that refers to another object as my edge, right? And then I have some other things here, like for the length and all of that. And I'm using it as a linked list, right? So I need get item. None of that is really going to be that useful here as I try to adapt this into a tree, right? And so I'm going to create a tree. And so there's different ways I could do that. If I'm going to be able to have multiple children, I can't just have one attribute for next. I may have to say something like children equals, and then I could have a list of children, right? I could have a bunch of nodes that I kind of have edges to. But for the sake of this example, I'm going to go even simpler. I'm going to create something called a binary tree, which means that each node has at most two children. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to say, well, left equals something, none, and then self.right equals none. Okay, so how am I going to do this now? Well, let me just kind of rename this down here. I'm going to say a dot left. I'll say a's left child is b, and then a's right child will be c. So let me kind of just take a peek at that. Okay, and let me just see what the structure will be like down here. It's going to be something like this, right? Just something like this. And so what I want to do for the rest of this example, right? I mean, I could create more complicated tree structures, and maybe I will, but what I want to think about is if I have some sort of tree that I use for computation like this, is there a way I can write a recursive function to turn that into a graph that I can visualize? Okay, so that's a strategy. And so how am I going to do that if I want to be able to visualize this structure automatically? Well, we've seen before that I could create this wrapper HTML, and then I could return some sort of HTML. Now, there's another very similar method that returns SVG files. And that's actually going to work nice for us, because an SVG file is an image file, and it turns out that GraphViz objects already have that capability, right? So let me just try calling this. I'm going to say wrapper SVG, kind of call that on my graph here. And you see it returns all of this stuff. It kind of looks like HTML, but it's actually, it's defining an image. It has ellipses that are filled with things, and there are strokes for lines, and all of this stuff, right? This here basically describes that image I'm seeing. And so what my strategy here is going to be is I'm going to say, wrapper SVG here. And then what I'm going to do is when I have this structure of kind of actual nodes I'm doing computation on, and I want to print it, well, I can create a GraphViz graph and then return that. So maybe let me try this. I'm just going to kind of copy this here for now. This is some horrible hard coding. But just so you can kind of see where we're headed. Oh, but I need self here. All right, so I'm going to create this graph here. And then what I can return, right? So this method needs to return a string containing SVG data, right? With SVG being that image format. And so I'm just going to kind of pass that work along, right? If I'm asked to do some SVG, well, I'll create a GraphViz object, and I'm going to get the SVG from that, right? And so let me run this, and you actually see, well, sure enough, now I'm actually getting my graph down here, right? You can see that because when I put this at the end of the node, What does Jupyter do? Jupyter says, well, is there a wrapper HTML? Is there a wrapper SVG? It kind of checks to see if I have any of these methods that Jupyter can use to show me something. And of course, here it finds the wrapper SVG. Okay. And of course, this is hard-coded, right? If I, let's say I have like a dnode like this, and I have dnode, and let's say that, let's say c.write equals my dnode. Well, it's not showing up because I just kind of hard-coded that simple graph with three nodes. Okay, so well, what can I do here? I need to somehow recursively draw myself, right? And so here's what I'll do. I need to check if my children are none or not, right? If they're not none, then I have to draw something. Otherwise, well, I can't really draw anything, right? So maybe I'll deal with my left child first. I'll say if self.left is not equal to none, then what? Then from this node, I need to draw an edge to that child node, right? So then I have to say something like graph.edge, and I want to point from the parent, who is me, to the child, which is in left, right? So I'm going to say g.edge, and then I want to kind of go from self to self.left. But I really want it to be like these values, right? The A, B, C. So I'm going to say self.value to self.left.value. And okay, so that's good, right? I can kind of draw that. It's not drawing the right-hand side yet, right? But at least I'm doing it programmatically, right? It's kind of based on the code I have. So I'm going to paste all of this here. And if I have a right child, then I want to draw an edge from myself to my right child. And so that's good. And so when I call this, right, well, what is this doing here? I'm really calling wrapper SVG on the root, and there's no recursion or looping or anything here. So I draw the edges from the root to the left and right, if we have it. Now, remember that C has a child as well, right? I said C.write equals D. And so to kind of get that right, I'm going to have to recursively call on my children, right? And so how will I do that? I somehow need to make them draw somewhere as well. And so, well, how can I do this? I guess I'm kind of in a tricky point, right? Because I don't want my children to create new graph viz objects, right? I just kind of want to do that once and then call this once, right? So even though I'm going to do recursion, these things should only happen once. So my feeling is that in order to make this recursive, I have to move this code that I've highlighted here to a separate function, right? So maybe I'm going to say something here like, draw edges, self, and then I'm going to copy this up here, like so. And then what I'm going to do is down here, right? Then rather doing all the draw edges myself, I'm just going to call it. I'm going to say draw edges, and I want to do it on this graph as object. So I guess I ought to pass that in, right? So I'm going to pass that in like so. I've just kind of refactored my code, right? I haven't changed the way it behaved. I just kind of moved all of this stuff into a separate function that I'm going to call. So when I run it, exactly the same, right? I haven't actually kind of done my fix yet. But what's nice now is that when I draw an edge from myself to my child, I can recursively ask my children to draw any edges that they have, right? So I can say, well, I want to call draw edges on my child. And so here I'm looking at my left child. So I'm going to say self.left.draw edges. And then I want to do it on kind of G, right? That's where I want to draw it. And then the same thing down here. I'm going to say write.draw edges. And we do that, and now sure enough, I actually get my full tree that I was interested in. Let me just add some more nodes to convince you that it really kind of works. So I'm going to add another node here. I'm going to say E equals node E, and maybe I'll say like D dot left equals E. Maybe let me add an F node. Like this, and maybe I'll say like d.write equals f, and that's kind of funny, isn't it? And I just, for whatever reasons, forgot to start capitalizing things, to keep capitalizing things. And so I can draw that tree, right? Just like so, it kind of works in general. So let me just look at this code for a moment. Think about what I did here, right? I mean, I kind of started off with one function, and I kind of had some prototype working where I didn't have any recursion going on. But what I realized is that there was some stuff I wanted to do once, right? And the stuff I wanted to do once was to create a GraphViz object and then kind of pull out the SVG from it. And so the stuff I wanted to do once could not be part of my recursive method. There were absolutely some things I wanted to do recursively, right? Because I wanted to do them for all the nodes in my structure, right? And so those things I wanted to do recursively, I had to put up in here. And maybe just to make an analogy to when we learn to write loops, right? I think that when people are first learning to write loops, it's tricky to think about, well, what goes inside the loop, what goes before the loop, and what goes after the loop, right? And so kind of the way I've split this up with the methods now is this is kind of analogous to what goes in the loop, right? This is the stuff that scales up as I have more data, right? That's my recursive function. And then I'll kick that off down here. But this gives me the opportunity by having two separate methods to have the stuff that would be kind of analogous to running before and after the loop, right? These will run once, kind of regardless of how much data I have. Okay, so there you have it. There's our tree. And what we're going to do next time, eventually, right? I mean, we created a pretty picture and that's fine, but that's not why people create trees. They do it to more efficiently look for data, to represent certain types of data, to various kinds of computation. And so next time we're going to learn how we can use trees to have a very kind of efficient lookup structure.